Open your Bibles for me. Oh, man. I know some of you were expecting do jumping jacks. That's not the sign? What is it? Oh, youth leave. I'm sorry. Youth, see ya, peace. All right. I know I forgot to let the youth go. I'm sorry. Title of the message, Judgment, Rewards, and Loss. Is that like kind of peaks and valleys? Judgment, rewards, and loss. I like that title. We are turning, because of Revelation chapter 4, we're turning to 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 8 to 15. That's our text today. Yes, we are still in Revelation. Yes, we are still teaching Revelation. We are just teaching it out of 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 8 to 15, and other references today. Why? Because last week we were in the throne room of God in heaven, and we saw the 24 elders that represent who? Come on, believe with me, man. They represent us. They represent the church. And those 24 elders were caught up in this incredible worship around the throne room in heaven. And then in verse 10 of Revelation 4, they cast their crowns before the throne. Do you remember? They cast their crowns, and I said, hey, don't worry about what those crowns are this week, because we're going to take a whole week to talk about that. Well, that week has come. So today we are going to look at believers. Hear me when I say believers. We're going to look at believers' judgment, rewards, and loss. Partly to understand what those crowns were about that we saw in Revelation chapter 4, but more to talk about this critically important yet most often ignored New Testament truth of the judgment seat of Christ. The judgment seat of Christ. Who's heard of the judgment or the bema seat of Christ? This is, okay, all right, but you guys are all scholars and Bereans. That's why you've all heard of it. Listen, this is an important subject for you to know. It's important for you to know within the study of Revelation, the judgment seat of Christ, other, you know, sometimes for us called the bema seat, because it's an easy and fun Greek word to say. That's why we say them when we can. The bema seat judgment, or the judgment seat of Christ, occurs after the rapture and probably during the tribulation at some point, but we don't know exactly when, but apparently it happens. It's not perfectly chronological, but the crowns that we saw the elders cast before the throne last week in Revelation 4, those crowns are given to us at the judgment seat of Christ. And last week we saw the elders with those crowns, and so we put two and two together and say maybe, probably, this has already taken place. Here's what I need you to hear before we pray and get started. This judgment is for believers only. This judgment is for believers only. If you've been born again, if you have truly put your faith in Jesus Christ, received Him into your life as your Savior and your Lord, you will be at this judgment. You have a guaranteed appointment at the judgment seat of Christ. Now, if you choose to reject Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you don't have to be at this judgment, but you're going to wish you were. Because you have a judgment coming too. It's in Revelation chapter 20. It's called the Great White Throne Judgment. That judgment reserved for unbelievers only. I need you to hear me today. You have a choice of which judgment seat you'll stand in front of Jesus Christ at. You want this one. You want this one. You want to be at the judgment seat, the bema seat of Christ with the believers, not at the Great White Throne Judgment for the unbelievers. You ready to pray? Let's just pray some more. Heavenly Father, God, we love you. We love prayer. We love communion with you. We just love to just connect with you, Lord. We love to just be caught up in your presence and to commune with you, Lord. And we pray as we do that, as we've been doing that in worship and in prayer, that now as we commune with you in your word, that you would speak to us, that we would hear your voice, that our hearts would be open, that your word would pierce us, Lord. That it would do its job, Lord. That it would drain the poison of the sin out of our lives, Lord. And God, that it would instill in us your new life. We just pray you would do what you plan and purpose in this place and for each of us today. Do it now, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Again, and I'm doing this on purpose. If Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior today, then all of your sins, all of your sin, past, present, future, they have all been paid for. They have been paid for, tetelestai. That is paid in full. It's a finished work. The judgment of God, the wrath of God that has to fall upon sin has fallen on Jesus Christ in your place if you have received him as your Lord and Savior. And that payment that Jesus Christ paid, it's a theological word called propitiation. It means that it was sufficient to pay for your sins, all of them. It was a sufficient price to pay for your sin once and for all, completely. And so Romans 8, verse 1 says, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And if your version adds a little section there, it's just a descriptive section. It's not a conditional section. Most of the manuscripts stop right here. There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Let me say again, it's important for us to understand that the judgment seat of Christ is not in any way about salvation. Have I hammered that? Are you okay with that? So when we go on, you're not going to go, oh, does this mean I might lose my salvation? You're not going to do that on me, right? I know you're not, because I'm going to keep telling you. The judgment seat of Christ is not about salvation. Your salvation issue is settled. It's finished. The judgment seat is not about determining your righteousness or lack of righteousness. However, whenever I build up a point, there's always a however coming. However, the Bible very clearly says, this is what you need to hear as a believer today, we will be judged on how we have lived our life here. We will be judged on how we have lived our life here. The place that that occurs is the judgment seat of Christ. And in this judgment, there is both rewards and loss. There go the name. Judgment, rewards, loss. It all happens at the judgment seat of Christ. One of the types, listen to that word, one of the types of rewards that you and I will either receive or lose at the judgment seat is represented, important word, represented by crowns. These crowns are the crowns we saw cast before the throne in Revelation 4, verses 4 and 10. So that's why we're kind of connecting it right here. And kind of my commitment to the Lord through Revelation is that there's so much in the Bible, not just New Testament, but really more Old Testament. There's so much that really explains and expands and expounds Revelation that my commitment to the Lord is whenever we come across one of these things that I will pause the verse by verse in Revelation and expand that truth. That's what we're doing today. In Revelation 4:4, there's actually three types of rewards listed. It's not just crowns, but we sit on thrones. The 24 elders sit on thrones. That is representative of a reward. And the 24 elders are clothed in white. That is representative of a reward. And the crowns are representative of a reward. You like how many times I'm saying reward, don't you? I know you. Just wait till I get to the other word. Let's study the judgment seat of Christ, okay? Guys, the judgment seat of Christ should impact your life every day. Every day, every day, you should live in the light of one day facing Jesus Christ. And we've made the gospel so palatable, which, you know, on one hand, it's good, but on the other hand, it's a little deceptive because maybe there's believers that think, hey, it don't matter, man. I'm saved. I'm good to go. I got an easy erase whiteboard, and it just doesn't matter what I do because it's going to get erased. Read more of the Bible. All right. Let's start in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, shall we, on our way to chapter 3. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Paul's talking about heaven in 2 Corinthians 5. It's a wonderful chapter about heaven. It's where we get that famous verse 8, where it says, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Not exactly our point today, but I want you to know we're talking about heaven in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. We're talking about heaven in Revelation. This is the connection. So we pick it up, 2 Corinthians 5, verse 9. Paul says, so whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. All right. That's a really big verse. That's a really big verse. And we need to really, really grasp it. Again, Paul's talking about us going to heaven. And Paul says, when you get there, you got an appointment with the judge. You, saved, sanctified, set apart, glorified at that point in the righteousness of Christ, you have an appointment with a judge. His name is Jesus Christ. He's sitting on a seat known as the Bema seat. And the purpose for this meeting, this appointment you have with the judge, is so that you can get exactly what you're due in exchange for how you've lived your life here. Do you see where some of the wacky, did I say wacky? Yeah. All right, then I'll just go with it. You can see where some of the wacky cults get all the, like, you know, you're cooler by your works kind of doctrines, right? The more doors you knock on or the more this or that you do, then because they pull stuff like this out of the Bible and then they just recreate it to facilitate growth of their concept. Quick little apologetics course there, or at least a cult course. This is what I'm trying to get at here. What you do here significantly impacts what will happen to you in heaven. That's true. The Greek word here that we're using is bema. I've already referenced it. It's a high place, the judgment seat, built in an open and a public square so everyone can see. That's important. And the Roman magistrate, whatever level of magistrate there is in that area, would sit on this high place. You can find an easy picture of the Bema seat in Corinth that's been excavated. They would sit on the high place and they would judge, they would administer justice to those who would come to them. They would also reward athletes from this high place, from this Bema seat. They would hand out the Stephanos, the crowns of victory. So Paul says, you know how you see those Bema seats all over the Roman Empire? He's talking to the Roman Empire. He says, you know, there's one of those just like that in heaven. There's a judgment seat just like that in heaven, and every single believer is going to stand before that judgment seat. And 2 Corinthians 5:10 says, at that place we are going to rightly receive exact compensation for how we've lived our lives here for the Lord. We're going to receive in direct compensation either worth or worthlessness, either value or worthlessness. The Greek words used here in verse 10, the ESV says good or evil. If you've got the New King James, it says good or bad. These are not the Greek words that would be used for righteousness or sin. Two different words. These words would be better used for fruit. You know, have you guys got a lot of tomatoes? I mean, there's so many tomatoes growing around here right now. We've got, you know, some tomatoes, more than we can eat. I eat them like apples, but we still have more. And so I'll pick up two tomatoes, and one is good, and one is like, you know, and it's got like flies, you know, buzzing around. And I'm like, okay, that's bad. It means it's bad to eat. It's inedible. That's these words. Good fruit, edible. Bad fruit, disgusting. That's these words. Everyone is going to receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. The end of verse 10 says it's good or worthless. Again, it is not penalty for sin. Listen, you're a sinner. Every one of us. Those sins have been paid for and washed clean. We stand there in the righteousness of Christ. In fact, if we didn't have the righteousness of Christ, we wouldn't be able to stand there. Your sin is paid for, but still, you're going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ, and there is going to be a direct response to how you lived here. Let's turn to 1 Corinthians 3 and see how it pans out. Just over 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Here Paul's talking again about another really important subject for the church. He's talking about himself and Apollos as church leaders. And he's talking about, listen carefully, this is a planned kind of side lesson. He's talking about the foolishness of you and I following one church leader over another. He's talking about the utter foolishness of being connected to a church leader. Like, how foolish is that? If you've been around for a while, maybe you've been connected to a church leader that you felt like, oh yeah, man, I'm connected to them, you know, right up until they fall miserably and horribly in sin. And then you're like, oh, now what do I do? Learn not to get connected to a church leader. Connect to Jesus Christ. That's Paul's point here. 1 Corinthians 3, verse 5, Paul says, he and Apollos are only servants. They're only instruments for the Lord. And Paul says, one of us plants, one of us waters, but neither of us are anything. Please hear the apostle Paul. No servant of God that is serving God correctly is anything, period. And if there is a servant of God who is becoming something, then back away. Because you don't know how big the strike zone is for God. No one who's serving God correctly is anything. Why? Because only God is anything. Only God is everything. Only God gives life. Only God causes growth. And anyone else that's serving him is nothing but an empty vessel. 1 Corinthians 3, verse 8, we're picking up Paul's teaching. It says in verse 8 of 1 Corinthians 3, he who plants and he who waters are one, meaning of one body, and each will receive his wages according to his labor. Paul says, look, all of us who serve the Lord, we're one, we're of one body, but each of us will receive his wages according to his labor. Each of us will receive his own wages. ESV uses the word wages. Some people don't like that. The most literal Greek word is recompense. Each will receive their own recompense. It's their just due. Most translations put here reward. There's a little bit of a problem with that word reward. The Greek word most literally translated recompense, listen carefully, has equal positive and negative uses. And so reward isn't exactly right or isn't most right because it's just due recompense for something you've done for your labor, as Paul says. So that means when, as Paul's talking about the good and bad, when he says wages, as ESV says, it means whether they're of value or whether they're of worth, or whether they're worthless, you're going to get back exactly what you're due when we stand before Jesus Christ. Now let me just start telling you, and this is, I'm going to try to make this point really clear as we go on. Though we will receive correct compensation for our effort, it is not quantity of effort. It is also not quantity of results. It's not. We're going to develop that more and more as we go, but I want you to know right now that whether your service to the Lord is good or worthless has nothing to do with how you or man or the world measures success. One of the most horrible things, in my opinion, that we as a church culture do is give accolades when a whole bunch of people follow someone. If that's our criteria, then Oprah Winfrey should get our biggest accolades, because she's got the most people tied to her online church as any church in the world. And God doesn't measure what your worth is compared to someone else's. And I'm telling you right now, I know missionaries in the field who will give their lives for the hope of one salvation in the bush somewhere. And, you know, so what if a guy's got enough people he can fly around in a Learjet? God doesn't measure it that way. God measures how you serve the Lord, where He puts you. It's not quantity, it's quality. It's the way we serve. We're going to get into that in a little more. I want you to know before we move on that you can receive all the rewards that are available to you right where you're at, in the station of life that you find yourself, right in that place. You can receive all the rewards that God has for you. As He's given you the grace, you can receive all that He has in that grace right where you're at. Right where you're at, because it's not measured as we measured. It's not about quantity, it's about quality. You'll see it as we go on. Continuing, Paul says in 1 Corinthians 3, 9 and 10, He says, "For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field, God's building." Verse 10, "According to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation, and someone else is building upon it. Let each one take care how he builds upon it." This is a very interesting set of verses. Paul's talking about labor for the Lord, and he's talking about he and Apollos, and so this is used a lot for those who serve, you might say, professionally. But then Paul switches metaphors. Some say he mixes metaphors, but most say he switches metaphors. If you look real close in verse 9, he says, "You are God's field," and then he just switches abruptly to God's building. And so most scholars, you know, will say at least half, believe that Paul is switching from focusing on those who labor for the Lord, as in instructing God's people, to the responsibility of those that they have laid the foundation for, meaning us, all believers. And so he switches the metaphor there from field to building. And then he says, listen, I laid the foundation. I laid the foundation. Now, let each one of you take care of how you build on it. Be careful. And again, a text that's used for ministers to incite the correct fear of God and how we minister to people, but also equally important, and today, broadly more important, it's how you are building your life in Christ on the foundation, and there's only one foundation. Verse 11, 1 Corinthians chapter 3, "The only foundation there is to be laid has been laid in your life if you're a believer today." 1 Corinthians 3:11, "For no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ." So every person who stands at the judgment seat will have the foundation of Jesus Christ in their life. If you are saved today, you have an eternal foundation of Jesus Christ in your life, and your salvation in Him is secure because He finished the work, and He'll finish it in you. But your righteousness is done where Christ is, if He is truly your Lord. But what you build on that foundation of Jesus Christ matters. It matters significantly to God, and one day it will matter significantly to us, the day we stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Here it is, 1 Corinthians 3, 12 and 13. "Now if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become manifest. For the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire. And the fire will test what sort of work each one has done." That is two huge verses there. Absolutely massive. Verse 11 says the foundation is Jesus Christ, He and He alone. Verse 12 says what we build on that foundation is, listen carefully, it is Gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw. Notice, no ore. There's only one dynamic translation that puts the word ore in there. It shouldn't, because there is no ore in there, because this is not an either or deal. Listen, get over yourself, okay? You're not going to have all gold, silver, precious stones. If you think you do, that just proves your total building is made of straw. All right, I'll just tell you right now, every single one of us, every believer that comes here will be dragging some wood, hay, and stubble with us, okay? Every one of us. That's why there's no ore there, because God knows it's all of it. Prayerfully, it's all of it. I guarantee you, you got wood, hay, and stubble or straw. The question is, do you have gold, silver, and precious stones? Here's the short answer. Do you want to know the short answer for which is which? Short answer, because this is complicated to do all this in one, 60-minute message. Like I have that long. I may take that long, but it's not how long I'm given. Here's the short answer for what is gold, silver, and jewels, and what is wood, hay, and straw. You ready for it? Everything done in the flesh is wood, hay, and straw. Everything. I don't care if you got the biggest church in the world. If it's done in the flesh, oh, that's going to be a bonfire. Everything done in the spirit is gold, silver, and precious jewels. Everything done in the spirit is gold, silver, precious jewels. Everything done in the flesh is wood, hay, and straw. That's the short summary answer. Verse 13 says, everyone's work, each person's work will be made known, will be manifest, will be revealed. And remember, the bema seat is set in an open and public place. And it demonstrates the openness and the public environment in which Jesus Christ judges our lives. Everyone's work will be made known for that day. It's literally the day. It's a certain day. It's the day of the judgment seat of Christ. We'll disclose it, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. So gold, silver, jewels, wood, hay, straw, all it takes is a little fire to tell the difference, right? I know it's a little bit shaking to say, what? You mean there's actually benefit if I live for Christ and there's loss if I don't? Yeah. Better to hear it now than then. Because you're going to be like, hey, can I go back? And Jesus is like, not wrong religion. NLT says here in verse 13, the fire will show if a person's work has any value. The fire will show if a person's work has any value. Not how much work, not if you did work, not how busy you were. Does it have any value? Does it have an eternal value? It's what sort. It means what quality, what type of work. We're going to define what sort or what type of work as we go, but I need you to understand it's not busyness. Sometimes the people that do the most in the church are mostly in the flesh. And it's just terrible that church leaders, me included, us as church leaders, we say, well, at least they're doing something, Wrong. The fire will test what sort of work, what type of work. Let's see what happens on the other side of the pizza oven first. Have you ever seen these pizza ovens? I think Little Caesars uses them, where they put a raw pizza in at one end, and then like 6 feet away, a finished pizza comes out. I'm like, wow, that's really cool. That's how I see the judgment seat. It's like, okay, I'm up. There's all my works going into the pizza oven. And then I run over to the other side. I'm like, come on, something besides ash, come out. First Corinthians 3, verse 14. If the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward. So everything you've done for Christ gets put in the pizza oven. And what comes out the other side, if it survives, it's your reward. Oh, that's really, really good. Now, here's the interesting thing that just proves how well God knows us. The details of these rewards are never given. Isn't that good of God? Because our flesh would just go wild with those, man. Our flesh would just, it'd be ugly. And so God never gives us the details of these rewards. He never really tells us. So in general, He tells us there will be rewards, and you got to trust Him for what that means. So let's talk a little bit about the rewards that are coming. First, there are crowns. That's what brought us here to this point. Numerous crowns mentioned in the Bible. Here's this about the type of reward that is represented by crowns. I'm using those words carefully because I don't want you to think, really, I'm going to serve the Lord and what? I get a tiara? What? You know what? No, it's represented by the crown. The word Stephanos is actually, I think that's the Italian way to pronounce it. Stephanos. It's actually a wreath. It's actually a wreath, a live wreath. It represents the reward. Here's the thing about all the crown rewards. They are all similar in this manner. They all represent faithful, unending commitment to Jesus Christ. Man, I had a chance to sit with an old friend yesterday who has been serving the Lord faithfully for 20 years in the same place without wavering. Without wavering, this guy has gone through thick and thin and a whole bunch of both, and he is just steadfast. And a whole bunch of us were used by God to build that ministry, and he's the only one left. And I just said, man, I'm so proud of you. I'm so proud of you. He began setting up children's ministry rooms in 1992. Later, we found out that the stress was so high of him doing all that work that he was smoking a joint on the way to church every morning. So we corrected that in it. And now this guy is a pillar in this ministry. 20 years later, he hasn't moved. Every one of the crowns is given for those who have given faithful, unending, never-say-die service to the Lord. Here they are. I'm going to list them. 5 types of crowns in Scripture. Write them down. Read them later because I don't have time to get into them. 1 Corinthians 9:25 and following is the victor's crown. That's the one for running strong, running well, for winning the race. 1 Corinthians 25 and following. Next crown, 1 Thessalonians 2:19, the crown of rejoicing. This is actually the people that we serve. Paul says, you are my crown. You are my crown. That's the crown of rejoicing. 2 Timothy 4, verse 8, the crown of righteousness, save for those who are longing for his return. Do you always have one eye on the horizon? You're like, come on, Jesus. Great day, man, to crack the sky. That's that crown right there. The crown of righteousness for those looking for his return. James 1, verse 12. Revelation 2, verse 10. The crown of life. It's for enduring hardship. Listen, I don't care where you're at. If God has you in a hard place, you can bring glory. You can give him honor. You can push through that in the spirit and crucify the flesh, and you can prepare for yourself rewards in heaven for eternity right where you're at. That's the crown of life. Don't let anybody ever tell you that if you're in hardship, it's because God's not blessing you. What if it's the greatest blessing? 1 Peter 5, verse 4, the crown of glory. That's the one for faithfully serving the Lord, the crown of glory. So each of those are great truths, great rewards, and you can dig into them later. In fact, here's what I'd really love, is I'd love for one of you to go, man, I want to dig into this. I want to learn about our rewards, about the judgment seat of Christ. I want to be prepared to get rewards and not lost. And maybe I could inspire you, maybe the Holy Spirit would inspire you, and I would just ask him to say, hey, I'd like to start a little study group on that. We call those discipleship groups. I would love for you to do that or do it yourself. These are my two favorite books on the subject. Number one, Your Eternal Reward by Erwin Lutzer, pastor of the Moody Church in Chicago. Erwin Lutzer, who's a great writer and scholar, Your Eternal Reward. The other one is Facing Your Final Job Review, Woodrow Kroll, Back to the Bible, President of Back to the Bible. Great, both great books. I read them both this week, and they're just really well done. So those are great books for you. All right, here's the thing about casting crowns, okay, before the throne. I need to tell you this. The rewards the Bible talks about are eternal. All right, they're not, a lot of people say, oh, the only reason we're getting a crown is to throw it at Jesus' feet. Yeah, well, you just don't get it, man. You just don't get it. First of all, the fact that you're there should cause you to throw everything at his feet today. Amen? I mean, that's a really big deal. But the crown is representative of a reward. Just in the last week or so, I saw an Olympic athlete, maybe you saw this, take a gold medal. I think it was gymnastics. Take a gold medal off her neck and put it on her coach's neck. Did anybody see this? It was really, really touching. And she was recognizing her coach's role in her gold medal. Now listen, the fact that she took her gold medal off and put it on her coach's neck doesn't mean he's the gold medal winner. He's like, oh, fat Russian guy, you know. He didn't just win the women's, you know, balance beam. He's just wearing the medal because it was given to him by the one who earned it. You get the picture? So when we cast our crowns before the throne, it doesn't mean we lose that reward. It's representative of the reward. You look silly running around heaven with a crown on anyway. All right, the crowns are only one of five types of rewards as I move quickly to the close here. Oh, I said that way too early. It's not even time to give that false warning. Five types of rewards. I know it's hot. Pray, man, pray. There are five types of rewards in Scripture. The five crowns, which we just saw, write these down, study them too. Matthew 6, 19 and following, you know this text, Matthew 6 text. 19 and following talk about your treasure, your heavenly treasure. And Jesus says, where you store your treasure is where your heart will go. Okay, read it for what it really is. Where you send your treasure is where your heart will ultimately be. So send it into the world, that's where your heart will be. Send it into heaven, that's where your heart will be. Heavenly treasure. Matthew 25, 21. You see how I just slipped that little teaching in there? Matthew 25, verse 21 and Luke 19, 17 are the rewards of commendation. I believe these are the greatest rewards, personally, and maybe the last ones too. But the commendation, that's the well done. That's the well done, my good and faithful servant. Next, Revelation chapter 2. Four times in Revelation chapter 2 to the different churches, a reward is promised to the overcomer. Those who are victorious, those who just hold on to Christ in the midst of their circumstances and their situations, and they never turn from Him, and they never turn to their flesh, they never turn to the world. They're overcomers, and four times special rewards are promised to them. The last one, Matthew 19, Matthew 24, Matthew 25, Revelation 2. All rewards of responsibility and authority. Now, if you've had responsibility and authority, you might not think that's a reward. but with Jesus, it'll be easier, especially in the millennium. Maybe not. I don't know. Anyway, responsibility and authority, that's a reward. Four places at least where that is seen. So all these rewards, the crowns, the treasure, the commendations, the overcomer rewards, the responsibility and authority ruling and reigning with Him, they're all real. They're all real. They're all real. They're more real than what you experience today. You're saying, God bless me. Why? What if tomorrow's your last day on earth? God, show me how I can store up rewards in heaven in case tomorrow's my last day on earth. 400 to 500 people at Jeremy Van Loo's memorial service yesterday. Probably 500 people. Listening to a kid at 26 years old that God took home in an instant with no warning. And not by an accident. Tomorrow's guaranteed to no man. It was a wonderful service, and Jeremy incredible, the legacy he left at 26 in this community, the legacy for Christ. But next time you say, God, please bless me in this life, think about it. Eternity, blink of an eye. Vapor, eternity, and choose where you want your blessing. These are the rewards for that. All right, we got to move on to the other side, don't we? There's another side. I got to hurry to it. We stopped at 1 Corinthians 3, verse 14 to talk about the rewards. So we paused, talked about the rewards, and you'd like to go, okay, that's enough, Dave. We're gone now. We've talked about my rewards. Oh, you only just haven't told me exactly how to get them, but I'm done. No, there's another verse. And you have to hear what's in the other verse. It's verse 15. 1 Corinthians 3, 15. If anyone's work is burned up, it's in my mind. If anyone's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, though he himself will be saved, but only as through fire. If what we present to Christ on that day, on the day of the judgment seat of Christ, is burned up, we will suffer loss. We will suffer loss. And you're like, yeah, but we're in heaven. Listen, we're going to suffer loss. We're going to suffer loss right there. We're going to still be saved, but only as through fire. Let me remind you again, we're not talking about salvation. Let me remind you again, we're not talking about punishment for sin. That is not the loss that we're going to suffer. So what kind of loss is there? Listen, guys, you are going to be, alert and a person, you're going to have emotion. Look at God. God has emotion. And so just imagine yourself standing before the glorified Christ on the judgment seat. And all of your life for him goes into one end of the pizza oven. And then at the middle of the oven, it goes boom. And there's such a big explosion. You're standing there looking like a chimney sweep in Mary Poppins. And you're covered with ash and soot. And there's nothing coming out the other side. I promise you at that point, you are going to feel loss. You are going to feel loss. You're going to suffer loss, and I will too. You will still be saved. But if you get to that point and realize, I got nothing but ash and soot to offer my Savior and the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and all I can do is offer him my ash and soot from my life, there will be a negative response inside of you, I promise. That's what the Bible says. So it's not Jesus so much. It's not that we're suffering loss at the hands of Jesus. But we will suffer loss. As we hear the angel like, bring in the air tankers. We got an out of control fire here. And a super tanker comes in to put out your fire, you know. All right, that was a pretty good picture in my mind. Fire's going to get out of control. Heaven's going to burn, man. The good news is that your loss isn't permanent. We know that. Because by the time we get to Revelation 21, although in both Revelation 7 and Revelation 21, there are tears to be wiped away by the Lord. He will wipe away their tears, meaning there are some to wipe away. But then, of course, by the time we get to 21:4, there is no more crying, no more grieving, no mourning. So this is temporary loss, but nonetheless. So let's talk as we close quick. We're rushing to the close right now. 1 John, turn over to 1 John. Let's talk about how. Don't you want to know how? Has the Holy Spirit at least like sparked you to say, okay, how? How can I get me some? Let's talk about it. 1 John chapter 2, 28, quickly. You're there? 1 John 2, 28. And now, little children, underline these words, abide in him. Now, little children, abide in him so that, in order that, when he appears, we may have confidence and not shrink from him in shame at his coming. Is it possible to shrink from Jesus Christ in shame at his coming? Apparently it is. If you would say, Lord, I do not want to do that, then he would say, then abide in me. That's what John says in 1 John 2:28. Abide in him so that you will have confidence and you won't shrink from him in shame at his coming. So for starters, listen. You've got to learn to abide in Christ. You've got to learn to abide in Christ. We have a series, a 10-part series called Abiding in Christ. Man, get it. Go through it and actually practice it. Begin to live it. So let me just give you the major summary. We'll talk about this more as we close. The major summary of building your life with materials that will be rewards at the judgment seat of Christ. If you don't remember anything else, remember this. Here we go. You ready? Anything you do for Jesus in your own strength is fodder for the bonfire. Anything you do for Jesus in your flesh or for your own glory is fodder for the bonfire. It is. It is. Contrasting, only things that are Christ in you, that God is doing in you and through you by his power, only those things will survive this judgment and become rewards for you. Anything you do without God in your own flesh and your own strength, I don't care how religious you are, God's not impressed. It's going to burn, man. And only what you allow Christ in you to do, whether he's doing it in you or whether he's doing it through you, it's called the Christ in you principle. And as far as Christ is in you and what Christ is doing in you and through you, those are the things that are going to turn into rewards. Those are the things that are going to turn into rewards. Turn over to John 15. I promise you, I'm trying to close right now. It's what it looks like when I'm trying. John 15, verse 5. Are you there? Guys, our rewards are not based on our activity or our effort. They are based on the Christ in us principle. Hear me, please. Our rewards are based on what Christ is doing in us and through us. John 15, verse 5, Jesus says, I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing, meaning nothing of eternal value. You can do apart from the life of Christ in you. All of your own religious efforts, all of your own good works, woof. It's just going to vaporize in front of Christ. So first and foremost, let me share and you hear. It's Christ in you. So get some. Get Christ in you. Get him in you. Get him in you. Crucify your flesh. Allow Jesus Christ to live in you so that you can actually have something to show for your life here when you stand in front of him. Galatians 2:20, you know the verse. I've been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Guys, this is the Christ in you principle. We have another series on this called The Fundamentals that just talks about how do you get the Christ in you principle. Now, here's the problem, is you want a practical list. You do this. If you knock on 200 doors and ride your bike for 2 years, you're gonna get a reward in heaven. I knew I'd get one out of you there, huh? Listen, that's what you want. That's what you want. And if I were to give you that, I would just be feeding your flesh. I would be selling you straw to fuel the bonfire at your judgment day. If I were to tell you, you just go do this and go do this and go do this, you're like, okay, I can do it, man. I can do it. I've won every contest I've ever been in. I'm gonna win some stuff and I'm gonna get some reward. And then I have to answer to God. It's Christ in you. You get Christ in you, he'll do what he chooses. And when he does what he chooses in your life, then it glorifies him. And when your life glorifies him, you have rewards in heaven. Don't you see it? Amen. You get Christ in you, he'll work it out. He completes it. Listen, you are his poema. You're his poema. Ephesians 2, verse 10, for we are his workmanship. We are his poema, his work of art. We're created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. You want rewards in heaven? Then you get Christ in you and you do what he's made you to do. You allow him to do in you and through you what he's made you to do. And he gets the glory and you get the reward. This is an all good deal. This is a win-win deal. What's God called you to do today? You can serve him right there where you're at. Who has he made you to be today? You are his work of art. You are his poema. He wants to do a work in you. And if you will allow him right where you're at, then he will be glorified and you will get the reward in heaven. It's as simple as that. You can serve him right where you're at. You can walk by faith. You can walk in the Spirit and crucify the lusts of the flesh right where you're at. You can glorify Jesus in your life today. You don't have to move. You don't have to get a new spouse. You don't got to get a new job. You can glorify Jesus Christ right now today. And every time you do, you're storing up something in heaven. Is it bad motivation? Take it up with God. He's the one who gave it to you. Glorify Christ in your life and know that it's worth it. And so whether you're in a concentration camp, whether you're in a jail cell, whether you're on top of the world, where God has allowed you to be, you can glorify him. And as you glorify him, you will be setting aside reward in heaven. Colossians 3:23 to close. Whatever you do, I would paraphrase, say, whatever it is you're doing, work heartily as for the Lord and not for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward. You are serving the Lord Christ. Amen? Let's pray. Oh, Lord, it's all Jesus with you. It's if we'll just surrender, Lord. If we won't mix our flesh in, if we won't love the world and try to love you, if we'll just go all in with you, Lord, it's win-win. It's all win. You give us peace and strength. You lead us and you guide us. You use us. Lord, we're allowed to manifest your glory, your nature, your character in this life. And then when we get to heaven, you give us rewards based on what you did through us. Lord, there's nothing in it about us. We are absolutely nothing in this whole picture except that we surrender to you. And so, Lord, today we take self off that throne and we put you there. And we say, Jesus, we want you in us. We want you to live in us and through us. We want to glorify you. And Lord, we want something left on the other end of the pizza oven. Convict us. Right now, I just want you to pray. Okay, I'm just going to be quiet, actually. Not for long, though. It's really hard for me. I'm going to be quiet. You need to deal with God right now. Right where you're at, you can glorify him. You can serve him. You can allow him to live in you and through you right in your situation today. You decide right now if you're going to do it, and if you are, tell him. Just tell him. Lord Jesus, may we be all in, sold out, surrendered to you. And if there's one person listening that doesn't know you, use this message to drive them to the cross for good. In Jesus' name, amen.